Those of you who have dreamed of becoming a race car driver, take note. Brian Hammond's just completed a school where they teach you to drive a race car, and he's near as you survive, first of all, and you're here with this report.
Tracy, growing up in central Indiana, I've always been a racing fan. It's hard not to be. But as I found out at the Skip Barber Racing School, being a fan and being a driver are two totally different things. Driving a race car is not an easy task.
I was finally going to drive a race car. Me and 13 others in the Skip Barber Racing School. 11 of the 33 drivers at Indy this year have taken this same school. In fact, Danny Sullivan is one of the instructors. There were no big names in our class, just a bunch of guys who wanted to try racing for different reasons.
I enjoy racing, and always, ever since I've been a little kid, I can always remember I always wanted to be a race car driver.
I've had a little bit of experience, and I found out there's a lot of difference between being a street racer and really racing on a track against competition.
Oh, well, I've always been a race fan, and I thought that, you know, I might as well see if I liked it as much out here.
How long have you had your license?
About 6 months.
This was the three-day competition course. We would learn in Formula Fords, and there was a lot to learn in 3 days.
I want to emphasize that the program is start out slow, learn the basics. The basics are line and downshifting. Footwork, we call it. Without those two basics, you cannot go fast. We're not going to go around the racetrack this morning, but we are going to do this slalom. It's a silly little thing, but it gets you hooked up. You start feeling the cornering loads. You start learning how to turn, because a lot of people want to turn too soon.
It was finally the time we had all been waiting for, a chance to drive a race car, although at low speeds through a pylon course in the rain. I'm in the black number 5, by the way. Kind of reminds me of the John Player Special Mario Andretti used to drive on the Formula One circuit.
Best thing to do is accelerate through gradually. If you let off in the middle of the exercise, that's not good. It could spin you.
As the speeds increased on the wet track, I found out it wasn't as easy as it looked. Danny Sullivan spun, didn't he? The next thing we needed to learn was how to downshift the race car, a technique that needed the footwork of a ballet dancer.
Come off the clutch, blip the throttle, back on the clutch, and complete the shift to third.
Finally, we have become familiar enough with the cars to take a full lap around the racetrack, again at slow speeds, about 60 miles per hour. Worked in groups. While one group was driving, the other was with an instructor observing. In this case, learning the proper racing line around the track.
That is the turning cone. It'll seem ridiculously far, but it works. He's turning about right. Little footwork problem there.
By the end of the day, we were lapping at about 70 miles per hour, and that seems fast when you're sitting just a couple of inches off the pavement.
Just watch it, because when you turn in with your wheels in the grass, the back end will come out, and it's all over.
I think it was a good day. So just keep on top of your game, and we'll see you at 8:30 in the morning.
We were all feeling pretty confident by the second day, but day two brought about more complicated maneuvers. First, an example of how well a race car brakes.
Threshold level can be heavier still.
Then a maneuver called trail braking, which is braking and turning at the same time. Something that takes a good feel for the brake pedal, and it takes some work.
Oh, Brian, you meanhead!
Your threshold braking level needs to be a little heavier.
Harder going in.
Harder going in. Now, when we lap on that, I want you to work on that area, okay? All in all, not a bad job. Pretty good feel for the car.
It didn't look like we were going very fast, but tomorrow on our part two of our report, we will be flying.
Were you scared?
Not scared, apprehensive on the third day, because we were going very, very fast, but I had a ball.
Well, good. Stay tuned. Howard's in.
Today, Brian Hammonds has part two in his close-up series on learning how to drive a race car. Yesterday, Brian learned the basics. Today, he puts it all together. Brian?
Howard, the third and final day of the course was the most fun. For the most part, The learning was over. It was time to develop our skills as potential race drivers.
There was a different look on everyone's face the third day of school, a nervous look. This was the day we would be going fast.
If you make a mistake, if you blow the downshift, if you're off the line, just remember, put it behind you, try and gather up where you are, and just concentrate on what's ahead of you. Motor racing, I don't believe, is a sport for historians.
We were turned loose at 4,600 RPMs and worked on a drafting and passing drill in turn six with three cones simulating another car. Luckily, we weren't passing other cars.
In early for five. He got on the line then, finally. But remember, if you're turning, you can't brake at 100%.
As the speeds increased, so did the incidents on the race course.
The reason that he spun was because he couldn't brake and blip simultaneously. It was footwork. So when he released the brake, what did he do? He got rear braking only, TTO, and that's why the back came around just the way you saw it. Nice, easy, gentle spin.
Skip Barber got off easy with our group. Only one car got into the guardrail. Everything we had learned over the past 3 days was starting to fall into place. It was getting easier and a lot faster. The instructors were on the lookout for any bobbles. At these speeds, it could be costly.
He's driving pretty hard. Nice shift, nice transition. He turned a little bit late. That's why you heard the rear wheel squeaking like that.
Finally, it was time for our final run of the class. Time to put everything together and go faster than we had ever gone before.
We have no guarantees, written or implied, at this stage of the game that any corner here can be taken flat out. That's never been the purpose anyway. Things are going to happen awfully quickly if you get offline and you do something wrong in the car. So I want you to really plug yourselves in, because at 100 miles an hour, you could be launched over that building. That's how high a Formula 4 would go at 100 miles an hour. And if you think I'm being facetious about that, I'm sure you've seen racing footage that's shown cars that high. I'm not. I've been 35 feet in the air in a race car.
All right. Brake harder in there, Brian.
Everybody has earned the right for a diploma, which actually acts as your provisional IMSA license and is half of your SCCA driver's schools.
Brian over here.
Thank you, Brian. Excellent job.
The Skip Barber Racing School is an experience I'll never forget. Some were encouraged to try racing. Some were humbled. But everybody has a new outlook on the sport.
Think about on the flight home tonight and see whether I really want to do it or not. I had a good time before I came in. I knew this is what I wanted to do. And it's humbled me somewhat when I spun out those three times. And I learned a lot.
It's a lot different than what I expected. It's a lot faster than what it looks.
Are you glad you took it?
Yeah. I think I learned a lot.
It really was a great course, and if Chris, who is 16 years old, never steps into a race car again, I guarantee you he'll be a better driver.
And you look right at home.
I've got to meet some other drivers. Greg Todd, who's your pro?